Sahanabhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavavai Tejasvinavagirmanastu Mahavishnavahai Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.
Samasta
Janakalyani Niratam Dharmayam Namami Chintayam Devam Sadguru Brahma Viparam.
Hari Om, salutations to all. Do you remember 10 steps?
Yes.
Without seeing the book.
Yes.
First, separation and posture. Moment of 20% of people remember. So why should we memorize this? Because only then we will be able to follow when we sit quietly. Otherwise we'll again open the eyes, again see the whole distraction, whole attempt of withdrawing the mind will go away. So we saw what meditation is not in the earlier session. It is not relaxation, it is not concentration, it is not absorption, it is not some special vision, not some special powers, not thoughtlessness. Then what is it exactly? It is effortless awareness of our own true nature. Swarupasya sahajam bhanam. It is a noun, so it is not a practice to do, it is a state to be in. And the practice is called contemplation, nididhyasa. And these 10 steps are 10 steps in nididhyasa. We also saw the preparation that is required. Physical, before we sit in the seat of contemplation, the preparation that is required is, that we forgot. Selfless action, moderation, doing one thing at a time, renunciation of fanciful imagination, four things. Then when we sit for meditation, contemplation, we sit erect, head, neck and the spine in a straight line, sit in a clean place, sit with palms facing the sky. Then when we sit internally, what is our preparation? The state of mind. We say prashantatma, calm, vigatabhi, free from all fear and hesitation, established in brahmacharya in moderation, devotion to the Lord. That is the preparation internally. So these 10 steps is what we had seen, and these have to get fully etched in our mind properly. The whole course will be only for this, to explain this. And the internal attitude we saw, calm, cheerful, fearless, be devoted to the Lord. Now, we also did last time, were you able to practice through the week with the audio?
Yes.
Some people maybe. Okay. Now, first point we had seen last time. Now we continue from there. Auto-suggestion. So three auto-suggestions we have to give. Auto-suggestion means we are instructing our own mind. We are telling our own mind something which will help the mind to decondition its old conditioning. So first thing, our first auto-suggestion is for the next 20 minutes or whatever time you are going to sit for contemplation, for that much time, I am steady and still without any movements. See, body we may make still and we sit down. But the mind is restless. And so the body also starts making movements. And one is not used to sitting like that still for a long time. So one has to tell that to the mind that, okay, no movement for the next 20 minutes, 30 minutes, whatever time it is. Now these auto suggestions are always said in first person, in present tense. Not that I will be steady. No, I am steady. And when we give this auto suggestion, one has to visualize that. So visualize whichever posture you are sitting, whether you are sitting on the ground or on the chair. Once we sit for contemplation, then while giving the auto suggestion, we have to visualize our own posture. And visualize that next 20 minutes, I am not moving. So now if you say, I am not moving, it will not work. If you say, I am steady and still. Positive language is what has to be used in auto-suggestion. Then comes without any movements whatsoever, that's okay. If you say, I will not move, that auto-suggestion is a weak one. So that is the first auto-suggestion. Second auto-suggestion is, I am alert, awake and quiet. All three words are important. I am alert. Next 20 minutes, my mind is going to be fully engaged in this activity alone, in contemplation alone, nothing else. So I am alert. I am awake. That is very important, because first obstacle that comes on the path of contemplation is sleep. And third one is, I am awake. I am quiet. Mind, when it is quiet, doesn't know what that is. It goes off to sleep. So that's why this auto suggestion is to reverse that conditioning. When I am quiet also, how I can be alert? And that is possible. We've just not trained the mind. Either it is an agitated state, or when it is quiet, it goes to sleep. How to keep that mind alert and quiet? That's a conditioning. We have to train the mind. So I am alert, awake and quiet. And the third auto suggestion is actually, I am a seeker. For the next 20 minutes, 30 minutes, no other roles are important. Everything else can wait. I am only a seeker. With that bhav, I sit for contemplation. And I am a seeker trying to realize my own true self. Actually, I am a seeker 24 hours, by the way. Other roles I play. But today it has become the other way. I pick up a role of seeker whenever I am sitting to do some study or some sadhana. Actually, it is the other way, because I am a seeker of truth throughout 24 hours. And I am playing the role of a father, a mother, a friend, employer, whatever it is. So I have to train myself to say that I am a seeker, because through the day also, what are my responses? How will a seeker respond? If you see something very interesting, some delicious food, which is your favorite food item, how will you respond as a seeker? With moderation or just attack? Every single moment, if somebody tells me something which I don't like, reaction is very normal. Anybody will react, but how will a seeker respond? So that mind has to be trained to respond through the day as a seeker, especially in the seat of contemplation, because many memories, thoughts are all associated with so many roles. And the mind always has something very important to do. When sitting for contemplation only, all those important thoughts will come. But I have to tell this to that person, I have to finish this job, and you know, I have to go to that place, and you know, I have to schedule that appointment, and all those fantastic thoughts will come, which otherwise they don't land up. I am very careless at those times. But in meditation, oh, a lot of concern about so many roles, except this one. So those 20 minutes, I say, no, I am a seeker. Even if any other thought comes, I again bring it back to whatever I am doing. One doesn't have to beat oneself up for it. Mind naturally will go here and there. Bring it back to whatever the practice one is engaged in. So three auto suggestions. What are they? I am steady and still without any movements for whatever duration of time. I am alert, awake and quiet. I am a seeker. You can use whichever word you want. Seeker, sadhak, bhakta, whatever you are comfortable with. But the implication should be that I am trying to know my true self or the Lord. Now third step. See, remember this is a whole process of step by step withdrawal of the attention from the outside to inside. So the third step is present moment awareness. Present moment awareness means bringing the mind into this moment fully. How to do that? Simple happenings that are happening around us, one should be aware. There can be sounds, there can be silence, there can be warmth in the atmosphere, there can be chillness, the ground below the feet, whatever is happening. One has to be aware, just be aware, non-judgmental awareness. Suppose you hear a vehicle sound, don't imagine which vehicle, what model, when was it released. You hear a sound of a bird. Don't consciously think about that. Just be aware. That is called non-judgmental awareness. No further thought. So bring the mind into the now. Be aware of whatever is happening around you. There's one buzzing sound right now that is there. So if you like, hold on to that one sound. Just be aware of that every moment. Sometimes there are many things happening. Just be aware of many things. Sometimes there is not much happening. Then you want to hold on to one thing. You can hold on to just any one thing. Idea is to be in the now. Away from the past and the future. Otherwise, generally the mind is away. Past and the future. And the mind is very funny. When in the present moment what is happening, it is not fully aware. So while walking, while being in the, you know, when we live in the world, you go past by the streets or even at home when you are staying there, there are so many sounds which we hear. Birds chirping. The trees are there, the birds are perched on it, the birds are chirping. The sound is there, but we don't pay attention. Then we will bring a CD of natural sounds and then put it on and then hear the birds chirping. It's a wonderful sound. It's beautiful. But while we were going, the birds were anyway chirping. So the mind which does not pay attention in the present, it finds all this. You know, go in the past, go in the future, get some support from outside. So be fully in the now. This practice will become more easy for us when we are doing that one thing at a time, what we saw earlier in the preparation aspect. So present moment awareness is to withdraw the attention from the past and the future, bring it to the now. And when we bring it to the now, we should remember one more thing, that every single moment is a new moment. So even if I hold on to one happening, it is one thing to hold on to that as it is happening now and be aware of it moment by moment. And it is another thing to make an image of it and then hold on to that image. So I should just be aware of what is happening now. A sound came, it went. Sometimes it's like this buzzing sound is there constantly. So moment by moment I'm aware of this sound. Not that, okay, now I'm paying attention to that sound and after some time, mind is somewhere else. Every moment. Because it's a new moment. There's nothing repetitive actually in every moment. A lot of things change. We are not able to perceive through our senses. But it's every moment happening. New change is happening. That's why it is. This whole world is called samsara. Because it's constantly changing. Samyak sarati. Every single moment it changes. Including our own body also. we think that this body is same, but every moment how many cells are born, how many cells are dying. So one has to be aware of one happening. That is step three. Now before we go to step four, what is step four? Relaxation of the body. We have to understand the connection. BMC, all of you are familiar with BMC. In Vedanta here, BMC is body-mind connection. So, the body is the instrument and mind is the user. Simple. Body by itself cannot do anything unless the mind through the brain instructs. This body will not do anything. So body is the instrument and mind is the user. Second aspect, body is made up of five gross elements and mind is made up of five subtle elements. Which means the mind is much more powerful than the body. So what we tell the mind will affect the body. Whatever happens in the mind will get reflected on the body. Every single emotion and thought in the mind translates onto our body through the brain. So mind works through the brain. Brain is a physical organ. Mind is intangible. Mind is thoughts, desires, emotions, which work through the brain. Like the phone is the physical instrument. The cell phone waves, they are intangible. They work through the instrument. Then we are able to speak. So mind works through this brain. And whatever happens to the mind will translate onto the body through that brain. So the attitude of the mind definitely affects. Positive attitude keeps the body healthy. Negative attitude creates stress, BP, heart problems. So many issues happen. Today it is very well documented. We all know it. What do the doctors say? 90% of the diseases are psychosomatic. Stress is the main real cause. Because one has allowed the mind to become so pressurized. So the body and the mind, if we go in the language of Vedanta, if we say the body is gross mind, and the mind is subtle body. Mind grossified becomes the body. And the body in its own subtle form is called the mind. That's why it's a subtle body. Mind is called subtle body. So every single thing that happens, you think about it, there is a whole transformation that happens in our body when we let go of even one stressful thought or a memory. Something that I've been holding on for such a long time, if I am able to let go of it or it gets resolved, how much the mind feels relieved, how much the body becomes better. People actually lose weight also when they start becoming stress-free. And they start putting on so much weight because there is stress in the mind. So a lot of this research is done. Our idea is, how do I use this? So the condition of the body affects the mind and the condition of the mind affects the body. So a sound mind definitely dwells in a sound body. So body must be kept healthy for the mind to function well. At the same time, mind also must be healthy for the body to function well. Relaxation is the step whereby through the mind we relax the whole body. We will see step by step how that happens. One doctor said this, we think with our muscles. Meaning, every single thought translates onto our body as a contraction. See, a muscle contraction in some part of the body. Every single thought. Like many times when a person is stressed, how are their shoulders? Very tense. Like that. When they relax, shoulder relaxes. So the emotions, they get locked up in different parts of the body. The more the stress one has, more it locks up in different parts of the body. For some people, it locks up in the back. For some, in the shoulder. For some, in the knees. Different parts. It will affect differently depending on what type of stress one has. If you want to know more details about it, read that book. You Can Heal Your Life. Louis has given so many examples. So many. What type of thoughts will lock up the emotions in which part of the body? She has given all the details. So every emotion. Now, with the body becoming stiff or body getting affected by that, different part thoughts and stress in the mind. In contemplation, when we try to withdraw the attention, it will not work. So first one has to relax the body. Let go of any stress or strain. Consciously relax the whole body. Because what we are trying to attempt is go beyond body identification. I am not this body is the thought I have to hold on to. How will I hold on to that thought? Unless my body is relaxed. Otherwise the body will keep giving some ache, some pain, some restlessness. Something keeps happening. Hence we have to do this process. That consciously relax the body. So what relaxation is not? Relaxation is not indulgence and diversions. Generally we say relax, just chill, eat something, watch some movie, go somewhere. In this context I am saying, otherwise it relaxes us, that's a different matter. But in this context it is not that. It is not being lazy, lethargic, and the mind being active, imagining all kinds of sense enjoyments. It is definitely not doing nothing. Relaxation is a conscious process. One by one I am relaxing the whole body, part by part. So what exactly it is? Imagine a car, if it is running with the brakes and the accelerator pushed together, what will happen? Can the car move forward? No. It gets spoiled very soon. Constantly our mind is doing something. That is the accelerator. He wants to do, extroverted it is. If at the same time I am trying to apply the brakes also, how it will work? So I need to withdraw and then do the relaxation. So relaxation means let go. To just let go. When I'm relaxing, I don't put. It's like when I put the brake, I don't put the accelerator. So it is to let go. Let the mind drop for some time. All the other concerns and all the emotions and stress that is locked up in the body, let it go consciously. So let go of negative energy, let go of stiffness, let go of inflexibility, let go of any contraction. How I hold the body in some stiff position, whatever contractions are there on the body, let go of all those and consciously relax it. So to do that is the process. What will we do in that process? The process is very simple. Mentally we are trying to do the relaxation. So using the mind and using the breath, we are going to do that. First step is we have to visualize the body. This is called the, there are two methods we will learn. One is called PMR, progressive muscle relaxation, which Gurudev used to call as thought massage. With every with the thought we massage every part of the body. Thought massage. Second is called light bath. Once the PMR is done, then flood the body with light. So we will see in detail as we go around this. What is PMR? Progressive muscle relaxation. So we visualize a part of the body. Let us say we visualize the left toe. We take a deep breath and then we say, relax, relax, relax. When we say this, we are exhaling. We have taken a deep breath. Attention goes to the left toe. Then we say, relax, relax, relax. As we exhale slowly, mentally we are telling that part of the body to relax. Whichever part I am visualizing, the energy is directed to that part consciously to relax that part, to let go of any hidden or locked up stress, contraction, whatever it is, and let it relax. The slower the exhalation is, the better will be the relaxation. So breathing must become slow, steady and deep. And consciously we relax each and every part of the body, coming from the toes to the head. That is PMR. And then the light bath. What is the light bath? We visualize the whole body and imagine a ray of light as though, which is above, it floods the whole body from the top to the bottom. As though one bucket of water is poured on you, how it will be? Like that, a bucket of light as though. The light enters the head, floods the whole body from inside. You have to visualize that my entire body within is filled with light. Flood the body with full light, white color. And it goes out through the fingers and the toes. While it is inside, if there is any pain in any part of the body, for example, if there is a back pain, then visualize that portion as black in color. And when the light floods the body, visualize that it takes away that black color. And the whole body becomes flooded only with light. There is no black spots anywhere in the body. So there is a back pain, knee pain, headache, whatever it is. Whichever part the pain is there, that part I must visualize as black in color. If you want to pay little more attention to that part also, you can do. Pay little more attention and ensure that that part is cleansed again and again with white light and it goes. This process must be accompanied by that PMR. If I have relaxed the body part by part consciously, then I visualize and I let go of this black color and the whole body is flooded with this white light. What happens with this? See, the body is nothing but a manifestation of the image we have about the body in the mind. So if my image in the mind is very clean, clear, flooded with white light, healthy, body will be healthy. But if the image in the mind is like that, you know, I have lots of pain, lots of problems, this is not so comfortable. If the image of the body is like that, then the body actually also will be like that. So these two is what we are going to practice today. So it carries away with itself all the stress and strain. This white light keeps flooding. So this I have to keep doing. Water, we may have a limitation. Conservation of water has to be done. This is visualization. Go on visualizing. As much as you want. Huge bucket. Light is poured. Again. Again. 5-10 times one can visualize that. Now the third thing which has to be done is, see, when we sit to relax, when we do the PMR, then we realize that so many different parts of the body, the emotions get locked up. We are not conscious through the day. So in the week, along with the practice of contemplation, these two steps that we will do now, we should do actions consciously. Every single act we do, try to do as much with awareness as possible. Aware of the body movement, body posture. See what all muscles we use. We don't even realize so many times. So walking, picking up a glass, writing, seeing, talking, ordinary actions. But we are not conscious of the way the body is being used by us. The more conscious we become, the less the stress and the emotions will get locked up in the body. So why do we contract our shoulders when we write? Many times we don't realize that, but our shoulders are very contracted. Why do we grasp the glass with so much of force? What doesn't require that much of force we do? Sometimes you keep an object. Not doesn't require that much force. But the mind, when it is disturbed or it is lost in thought, it just uses away too much energy. So this is to consciously act to conserve the energy as well as to be aware of the body. So these three things we have to do, two in contemplation and one in our daily practice.